Very good morning to one and all. Welcome to another online session of ASA. Today we have Dr. Sarita G, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Government College of Women, to take our online session. The session for today is Samuel Beckett's Beautiful Goddard. Please stay tuned for the wonderful points ma'am has got to share with us. Thank you so much for joining with us. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Good morning and welcome, dear students. In this session, I shall be giving you a somewhat broad idea about Samuel Beckett's masterwork, Waiting for Godot. Due to the constraint of time, I will not be able to do an in-depth analysis, but will definitely try to touch on all the important aspects and give you a general understanding of the text. Now, before I introduce the writer and the work, I would like to familiarize you with a few important concepts. Absurdism. In philosophy, the absurd refers to the conflict between the human tendency to find the meaning and significance of life and his inability to find it in a purposeless and meaningless and irrational universe. The Myth of Sisyphus, written by the French philosopher Albert Camus in 1942 and translated into English by Justin O'Brien, is the most important work on the subject. According to Camus, humans should respond to the absurd. That is, he should embrace the absurd. In other words, one's freedom and the opportunity to find meaning in life lies in the recognition of absurdity. Absurdism has some concepts in common with existentialism and nihilism. Existentialism. It is a philosophical and cultural movement that focused on the experiences of individuals to understand human existence. The existential movement became popular in the 1940s and 50s with the works of writers like Jean-Paul Sartre and Albert Camus. The central tenet of existentialism is that existence precedes essence. Søren Kierkegaard was the first existential philosopher. Existential attitude is a sense of perplexity or anxiety in the face of an apparently meaningless world. It is the individual. It is not the society or religion that is solely responsible for finding meaning to life and living it passionately, sincerely, and authentically. It is important to discuss existentialism because absurd is also similar to Kierkegaard's despair in his work, Sickness Unto Death. Kierkegaard's notion of despair is not synonymous with unhappiness. Unhappiness is something that affects the person, the body, and it does not affect the self. And Kierkegaard's concept of self, or Kierkegaard's self, is similar to the concept of soul. So if depression and unhappiness affect a person, despair is something that affects a self, because despair is some sort of a spiritual sickness. Talking about nihilism, nihilism is actually derived from annihilation. And it is a negation or rejection of all religious and moral principles in the belief that even life is meaningless. Nihilism is the belief that all values are baseless and that nothing can be known or communicated. It is often associated with extreme pessimism and a radical skepticism that condemns existence. A true nihilist would believe in nothing. He has no loyalties, he has no purpose other than perhaps an impulse to destroy and a desire to destroy. Nihilism is often associated with Friedrich Nietzsche, who argued that its destructive potential or its corrosive effects could destroy all moral, religious, and metaphysical convictions and precipitate the greatest crisis in human history. Nietzsche insists that there are no rules for human life, no absolute values, no certainties on which to rely. If truth can be achieved at all, it can come only from an individual who purposefully disregards everything that is traditionally taken to be important. Sartre's ontology In the book, a phenomenological essay on ontology written by the philosopher Jean-Paul Sartre in 1943, he develops a philosophical account in support of his existentialism. That is, in Sartre's ontology, what differentiates human beings from other beings is precisely nothing, or more accurately, it is nothingness. In fact, nothingness, according to Sartre, is identified with human consciousness. The greatest characteristic is freedom from determinism, which is the characteristic of matter. Now, keeping in mind all the terms which we have discussed now, we'll take a look at the theater of the absurd. The theater of the absurd is a post-World War term for a type of plays written by European dramatists in the late 1950s and early 60s. The term is taken from Martin Esslin's work, The Theater of the Absurd, which was written in 1961. In an attempt to clarify and define this radical movement, Martin Esslin coined the term the theater of the absurd, because all the plays of this kind emphasize the absurdity of human condition and existence. Absurdist theater was also heavily influenced by existential philosophy. It aligns best with the philosophy in Albert Camus' essay, The Myth of the Sisyphus, which came out in 1942. In this essay, Camus attempts to present a reasonable answer as to why human beings should not commit suicide in the face of a meaningless and absurd existence. Now, Camus uses the myth of Sisyphus as a metaphor for the human condition because of its persistence in the face of absolute struggle. And he uses the story of the Greek mythological figure Sisyphus, who was condemned to push a boulder up a mountain, only to have it roll it back down again. So he repeats this futile attempt, a futile cycle for all eternity. And at the end of the essay, Camus concludes that one must imagine Sisyphus happy. He means that the struggle of life alone should bring one happiness. Essentially, it is possible for us to find meaning in life even when we do not know why we exist. Now, incidentally, it is a similar type of a futile endeavor that forms the central theme of Waiting for Godot, where the act of waiting is a similar futile effort. We will discuss that later. So anyway, according to Albert Camus, absurd is something that is devoid of purpose. He's cut off from his religious, metaphysical, and transcendental roots. Man is lost, and all his actions become senseless, absurd, and useless. Now, these are some of the features of a typical absurd hero. He is ruthless, he is experienced, but at the same time, he's also disillusioned. He is unable to find the purpose or significance of life. He knows that life is futile, and he is deeply concerned with the problems of life. He has no past, he has no future, and even the kind of language that he uses is bare and functional. Playwrights of the Theater of the Absurd. Theater of the Absurd plays were written, as I mentioned earlier, Theatre of the Absurd plays were written by a group of dramatists in the 1950s with a philosophical bent of mind. And they had a certain attitude to the predicament of man in the universe. They mixed qualities of farce and tragedy. And they were also ironists who wished to be intellectual, ideological, objective, and cerebral. Beckett is considered the father of this style. And these are some of the other writers, some of the playwrights who wrote in the same style. Eugene Ionesco, Jean Genet, Arthur Adamo, Harold Pinter, Edward Albee, and so on. Now let us discuss the features of the absurd theater. The meaninglessness of life or absurdity of human life is the main theme in all their works. That is, the very act of waiting indicates helplessness, frustration, and the futility of human existence. The theater of the absurd ignored theatrical structure and was against all norms of conventional theater. It was also characterized by a total absence of a logical cause and effect relationship between the scenes. But the logic of the author's thought is expressed symbolically. It follows a non-linear plot. That is nothing, it has either no plot or it follows a cyclical plot. For example, in the play Endgame, it begins where it ends. The opening line of the play Endgame goes like this: it's finished, merely finished. So there is absolutely no conflict in the theater of the absurd plays. Nothing happens and everything seems a reflection of dreams and nightmares. Actions do not proceed in the manner of a logical syllogism. And dialogues, they do not make much sense. There is minimal speech and action, and sometimes silence is more meaningful or communicative than dialogues. Characters are absolutely unrealistic and unrecognizable. They are more like mechanical puppets, plots of many plays, absurd plays, feature characters in interdependent pairs, and they are also sometimes called pseudo couples. Focus of absurd plays is always on human beings trapped in an incomprehensible world. These plays also explored spiritual loneliness, complete isolation, and the anxiety of social failures and outcasts. And these plays almost never offered any logical or universal message. The theater of the absurd plays, they abandoned all conventions like plot, character, thematic structure, dialogue, and it was exchanged for expressive, ideational, and aesthetic reason. It was more like surrealism, very different from the theater of realism. In short, the theater of the absurd is anti-audience and anti-theater. It fulfills to some extent Bertolt Brecht's postulate of a critical and detached audience. The inspiration for absurd plays came from works like Maxim Gorky's Lower Depths and Doris Lessing's A Truth About Billy Newton and Each His Own Wilderness. Samuel Beckett was an Irish-French poet, novelist, dramatist, and a Nobel laureate. He is one of the pioneers in the avant-garde style of playwriting and theatrical presentation known by the term theater of the absurd. In 1969, he was awarded the Nobel Prize for Literature. Instead of attempting the slice of life kind of drama that was very popular in the early half of the 20th century, he preferred to be an iconoclast and invented a kind of drama without the traditional divisions into tragedy or comedy. It exposes us in our existential predicament. In fact, the very fact of non-action underlines Beckett's philosophy of the non-significance of life. He uses a negative approach in giving the viewer great freedom to form his own conclusions about life and its consequences. His bold and bare dramatic form is particularly suited to express a modern man's fundamental drama, an undefined sense of guilt, the feeling of helplessness and anguish resulting from a loss of identity and purpose. He also shared a very special and intimate friendship with James Joyce. In fact, his first work, which came out in 1929, was a critical essay titled Dante Bruno Vico Joyce. And this work was written to defend Joyce's works from allegations of wanton obscurity. Total theater means plays that are to be enjoyed in totality. That is, sound and silence are important, and it had more to do with communicating an experience. And such plays, playwrights, they expressed their vision of desolation with unique power. All the same, certain allegations or criticisms were also raised against Beckett. One was that he was a perverse messenger of gloom. And secondly, he wrote only of the extraordinary in terms of unnecessary complexity. These are some of the works written by Samuel Beckett. He's written short stories, novels. The first novel is Dream of Fair to Middling Woman, the trilogy, then drama, a poem. The poem Horoscope draws on the biography of Descartes that he happened to be reading around that time. Now we come to Waiting for Godot. Waiting for Godot is a classic in the genre of absurd drama, and it was written during the period of post-war disillusionment in the period 1945 to 1950. In this play, Beckett presents the audience with the image of a barren, hopeless world over which man has lost all control. Waiting for Godot, the English version of the French play, En attendant Godot, was a box office hit and established Beckett as a controversial dramatist of his time. It also brought the theater of the absurd to popular attention. The play presents the dilemma of the 20th century man, bound, fecund, and shackled. He is quarrelsome because he is unable to communicate. He is lost. He is unable to find purpose of his existence. In fact, Balzac's play, Marcadet, had a character called Godot, but he is different from the Godot in Waiting for Godot in that he turns up at least towards the end of the play. Structure. Waiting for Godot is a new type of drama, a new kind of drama without any of the traditional devices like plot or character, thematic structure, dialogue setting. The play has no exits, no entrances, no external conflicts, no exposition, no development, no denouement or reversal. Its structure is actually based on repetition, symbolism and motifs. There is also the use of parallelism with an admixture of contrast to break monotony. The structure is also built on symmetries. You find symmetries everywhere. Even now the speeches are symmetrically aligned. Acts are symmetrically constructed. Even the stage is divided, symmetrically divided into two by a tree in the middle. And just as in a human race is divided into two different types of characters. Plot. The plot of Waiting for God, talking about the plot, the play has actually no plot. In fact, it has a typical, or you can say that it has a typical cyclical plot where everything begins where it ends, or everything ends where it begins. In fact, nothing happens. So this is, Godot is a protagonist, but he remains invisible or unseen throughout the play. But he is conspicuous by his absence. When the play opens, the pseudo couple, the important characters in the story, Vladimir and Estragon, they are waiting at the side of the road near a tree. And then they are engaged in some kind of a casual conversation. And they say that there is nothing to be done. And Estragon is struggling to take off his boots. And Vladimir asks Estragon if he has ever read the Bible, to which Estragon replies that he did not remember anything other than some colored maps of the Holy Land. And this takes him to a conversation, a discussion on the two thieves who were crucified along with Jesus Christ. And in one of the Gospels, it is mentioned that one of the thieves was saved. They discuss all this, and then finally they are wondering whether it is true or not. And Estragon is constantly talking about leaving the place. And it is Vladimir who tries to make him stay on, saying that they have to wait there for Godot. And Estragon starts to describe a dream that he had the previous night, but Vladimir angrily stops him and tells him that he can keep his nightmare to himself. Now, while waiting, Estragon suggests that they hang themselves on a tree. And then they start disagreeing over who should hang himself first. And then finally, it is decided that they should just wait for Godot. Estragon asks Vladimir what Vladimir asked Godot for. And Vladimir says that he had made some kind of a vague sort of prayer. Even he does not remember it clearly. Then Estragon is hungry. Vladimir offers him some carrots. And then Estragon also asks if they are tied to Godot, to which Vladimir says they are. And at this point, the two characters are interrupted by a loud scream off stage. And at this point, the next pseudo couple, Pozzo and Lucky, make their entry. Pozzo, Lucky is a slave, and Pozzo drives Lucky forward with a whip, like a pack animal, and he and Lucky has a rope around his neck, and he's forced to carry Pozzo's Pozzo's articles. Estragon asks if this is Gordo, and Pozzo introduces himself, and he also offers Estragon some bones after he has eaten his chicken. And Vladimir is outraged by Pozzo's treatment of Lucky, and he wants to leave, but Pozzo stops him and stops him, though in case Gordo might turn up. And Pozzo tells Vladimir and Estragon that he was planning to sell Lucky at a fair, and Lucky starts crying. Estragon attempts to console him and hands over a kerchief, but then Lucky starts kicking him violently in the shin. Pozzo then makes a speech about the night and twilight, and then asks if there is something that he could do for them, because both Vladimir and Estragon were nice to him. And he offers to make Lucky dance and also recite. Lucky starts dancing, and his hat falls off. In fact, the hat is also significant, symbolically significant, because Pozzo says that Lucky needed his hat to think. And Vladimir places it back on Lucky's head, and Lucky then launches into a long and rambling monologue. Pozzo prepares to leave and says goodbye to Vladimir and Estragon, but then he does not move from there. Eventually, they leave, and Estragon also wants to leave, but once again, Vladimir tells him to stay on and wait for Gordo. And at this point, a boy comes on stage and introduces himself as a messenger from Gordo. He says that Gordo will not come today, but will come the next day. He tells Vladimir that he was working for Gordo, minding his goats, and that Gordo is a good master. And then he leaves the stage, and Estragon and Vladimir once again get ready to leave for the night. They say that they're going to leave, but again they stay on, and this is where the first act ends. The second act begins the next day in the same location and at the same time. Vladimir enters, and then they are happy. Vladimir and Estragon, they're happy to see each other. They embrace, and then Estragon asks what they should do. And Vladimir, as always, says that they should wait for Gordo. And Vladimir mentions Pozzo and Lucky, but strangely, Estragon cannot remember who these people are. And he's also unable to recognize the place. And he's able to remember is that somebody had kicked him, and he also remembered the chicken bones he got from Pozzo. Estragon wants to leave again, but Vladimir reminds him that they have to stay and wait for Gordo. Vladimir notices Lucky's hat lying on the ground, and then they start exchanging their hats, and then suddenly Estragon, he leaves the stage and returns shouting, "They are coming." Pozzo and Lucky enter. They are Pozzo is now blind, and he's following Lucky. Lucky stops when he sees Vladimir and Estragon, and Pozzo bumps into him, and all of them fall down. And Vladimir and Estragon attempts to help them to get up. They are unable to do it. And then finally, they help Pozzo stand up. But now even Pozzo does not remember either of them from the previous day. Vladimir asks when Pozzo went blind, and he replies that the blind have no notion of time. He asks Estragon to check on Lucky. Estragon goes over to Lucky and kicks him repeatedly. The two leave the stage, and Estragon falls asleep. But after some time, Vladimir wakes him up, saying that he was feeling lonely. So just like the day before, the boy once again comes on the stage, again with a message from Gordo that he would not be able to come that day either, but will definitely come the next day. Vladimir asks the boy what Gordo does, and the boy says that Gordo does nothing. Vladimir asks the boy to tell Gordo that he saw Vladimir. The boy leaves, and Estragon wants to go far away, but Vladimir says that they cannot go far because they have to come back the next day and wait for Gordo again. Estragon suggests that they hang themselves on the tree using a belt, and then they start testing the belt's strength by pulling on either sides, well, by pulling on either ends, and then it just snaps and breaks. Vladimir and Estragon prepare to leave for the night. They say they are going to leave, but neither moves on. So this is where the play comes to a close. Nothing actually happens. It is waiting at the beginning of the play, and it is still waiting towards the end of the play. The characters, there are just six characters in the play. Five of them are visible, and one character remains invisible. They are positioned somewhere between individuality and stylization, between relatedness and independence, between flat and round, between surface and depth, partaking of both of opposite spheres. They are never fully classifiable within either. They also represent abstract or spiritual meanings. Gordo is a mysterious personality. He has several features in common with the image of God as depicted in the Old and New Testaments. He does not beat the messenger boy. Gordo does not beat the messenger boy, but he beats his brother, who is a shepherd. So his irrational preference for one of the boys recalls Jehovah's treatment of Abel and Cain. Gordo is the main protagonist. He could also symbolize death. Vladimir and Estragon, the entire play is structured upon two pairs of characters with contrasting characteristics. So that is a cross-parallelism. And there is cross-parallelism between Vladimir and Estragon, and also Pozzo and Lucky. Vladimir thinks more, and he is more eloquent. His anguish is intellectual, and he appears stronger of the two characters. He seems more cultured, and he spends the night. He's more cultured and more educated, and he also quotes from Latin. He's practical, optimistic, always voicing the hope that Gordo will come. And he's also very caring, but at the same time, domineering too. In contrast to Vladimir, Estragon is the placid, intuitive type. He is the real lost man who receives blows regularly and spends the night in a ditch and begins a new day the next day. He is weak, temperamental, and always dependent on Vladimir. He is a symbolic representation of human decadence and deteriorating complexities of man's being in a world where even existence has lost its meaning. Estragon is constantly beaten up by mysterious strangers every night, but Vladimir is like a protector. He sings him. To sleep with a lullaby, and also covers him with a coat. Pozzo and Lucky are literally tied together. They're always together, and they're also tied together with a rope. In the portrayal of Pozzo, Beckett has given us the caricature of God, the absolute monarch, the bullying extrovert. Lucky is the timid introvert, depicting the lowest ebb of human existence under persecution. His characters are two extremes. At one end, he is extremely obedient. In the first act, Pozzo commands Lucky to think, and he commences the speech that at first appears like gibberish. There is no coherence, as random allusions and references are made. But there is a method in his madness. It is a reflection of the play itself in concise form. Even Beckett himself has said, the threads and themes of the play are being gathered together. In fact, Lucky's speech is in three sections. In the first section, he talks about an apathetic God, indifferent to the plight of man. He talks about divine apatheia, divine athambia, and divine aphasia. In the second section, he says that all efforts of man to improve himself ends in vain. It is actually an attack on academics and human sciences, which, according to which according to him are labors left unfinished. The reference is actually to empirical philosophers like Berkeley and Voltaire to subvert the notion of rationality in human beings. The third section establishes that the contradictions lead to the ultimate certainty, that is death. In this section, Lucky paints the most pessimistic picture of life, an apocalyptic earth where nature has run its course and only darkness would prevail. The speech then turns to incoherent ramblings, and even the breakdown of language actually suggests his inability to communicate the meaning that gives structure to life. Themes of waiting for God. The primary theme is the loss and chaotic condition of modern man, where there is so much confusion and paralysis that it renders him incapable of any action. Lewis Stang called Beckett the creator of the myth of nothingness. Choice is another theme. That is, the characters, they fail to even realize that the very act of waiting is a choice. But they think that it is a mandatory part of their daily routine and existence. They decide to leave many times, but they're unable to move from there. This inaction ultimately leads to stagnation and repetition. Truth, the play is actually driven by a lack of truth or uncertainty. Nobody knows what is happening. And sometimes you even feel that, you know, the whole thing is a dream, or there is a surrealistic atmosphere about everything. Time. The central action of Waiting for Godot is waiting. Forced to while away their days in anticipation of a person who never arrives. The impact of time reflects the burden of existence for those characters, which is contrasted and reflected in their relationships. Further, time has lost all its meaning and relevance. It does not matter whether it took a year, a month, or a whole youth in the forming of new leaves to yesterday's bear tree. It does not mean how long ago it was when Poso had a vision. It is again irrelevant that what time, it is again irrelevant what time God would come, but the characters are quite sure that he would come. Friendship. The characters are, there is actually no real friendship in the play. The characters are isolated from each other, and the relationship that they have waver between a fear of loneliness and an essential inability to connect. In fact, when Estragon falls asleep, Vladimir tries to wake him up, saying that he was feeling lonely. So probably it is as an escape from that loneliness that they try to form some kind of a relationship, which cannot actually be called friendship. Freedom and confinement. Each character lives in a prison of his own making. They are imprisoned in a state of passivity and stagnancy brought about by his own action. Brought about by his own inaction. Every character is a slave of the other. In fact, a slave is in a comparatively better position, or he is freer than the rest of the characters, because at least he is aware of the lack of freedom. Suffering. Suffering is a constant and fundamental part of human existence. Hardships are both physical and mental, with no respite in sight. Death is seen as a way of escape from life. Death is another theme, and it becomes a solution for the inanity of daily life. Godot seems to hold some promise of redemption or hope, even though Vladimir and Estragon forget what they want to ask from Godot. They threaten to commit suicide because they are unable to do it because they claim that they do not have the means, but it is also because they are uncertain about the result of their attempt. Waiting, boredom, and nihilism. The major part of the play is about waiting for the mysterious Godot. Nihilism is a denial of any significance or meaning in the world. It is a worldview centered around negation, claiming that there is no truth, There is no morality, no value, or even reality. Nihilism provides the psychological foundation for the play. Symbolism. The play is symbolically very rich. Godot himself is a symbol, and sometimes he symbolizes something that is similar to God. Waiting, again, waiting is a symbol. Waiting for Godot is waiting for redemption, waiting for resurrection, waiting for death, but nothing happens. The entire play is symbolic of the purposelessness of man's existence. The characters are trapped in a never-ending, ever-repeating cycle. They forget the past and they cannot learn anything from it. Existence is profoundly ritualistic, and there is a repetitive nature about it. Another recurrent symbol in the play is duality. Even while the characters Vladimir and Estragon contemplate suicide, they say that the branch may or may not break. There is a duality there. One person may live, the other person may die. There are two thieves who are crucified along with Christ. One may be saved and the other damned. There are two pairs of characters. So duality actually symbolizes or indicates the ambiguity regarding God, time, and existence. The only prominent piece of the set in the play is the tree, and it is discussed throughout. They wait, the characters Estragon and Vladimir wait near the tree to seek Godot, and the tree could also represent resurrection or regeneration. Even the branches make it look like some kind of a cross where Christ was crucified. The hat, as I mentioned earlier, is also a symbol. Each character in the play wears a hat except the boy, the messenger boy. Vladimir focuses on the hat, and he is a thinker. Estragon, he is always focused on his boots. Lucky can only think when he is wearing the hat. Pozzo shows his superiority by removing Lucky's hat. The rope. Rope represents the balance of power in the relation between Pozzo and Lucky. When Pozzo is healthy, the rope is long. But when he becomes blind and needs Lucky to guide him, the rope becomes shorter, showing that the distance and the difference has also become less. The bag which Lucky carries is to show his devotion towards Pozzo. Bone symbolizes poverty. Waiting for Godot as a tragic comedy. In the English edition, which came out in 1956, the play is titled Waiting for Godot, a Tragic Comedy, combining tragic and comic elements. The play opens in a humorous way. Godot's trying to take off his boots. He tells a funny story of an Englishman who goes to a brothel, calling each other names, ceremonious ape, and so on. The tragic element pervades the Lucky Pozzo episode. Pozzo becomes a pathetic character in the second act, and Lucky becomes dumb and mute. They gave birth aside of a grave shows the brevity of human life. The never-ending wait also creates the effect of pathos. It is a reminder of the tramp's state of hopelessness and vain anticipation. The mysterious person who has been beating Estragon, and that again is another tragic element in the play. The couple, the pseudo couple, Vladimir and Estragon, they plan suicide and moans that nothing happens, nobody comes, nobody goes. It's awful. All my lousy life, I've crawled about in the mud. And you talk about scenery, the pointlessness of human existence. Waiting for Godot is also an existential drama. The play is taken as existentialist in its take on life. It deals with the theme of despair. The characters do not retain a clear mental history, and they are in a constant struggle to prove their existence. The characters are thrown into an alienated universe, and they are moving from nothingness to nothingness. In spite of inaction, they still want to go on. Everything is absurd and irrational. Religious interpretations of waiting for God. The characters who attempt to understand religion or to understand religion logically are left in the dark. There is no knowing what is objectively true in the realm of faith or religion. The characters, they compare themselves to Christ as a model for their own suffering. Waiting for the mysterious Godot could be symbolic of mankind waiting for redemption and salvation. In Act 1, Vladimir and Esteban speak of addressing Godot with a kind of prayer. In the second act, the messenger boy describes Godot as an old man with long flowing white beard, which is a possible allusion to Godot. And to conclude, as an image of man's absurd and tragic predicament, waiting for Godot is a powerful reflection of a current state of mind and attains the status of a classic. Thank you.